in Washington in her absence, Evangelist Sanders in her absence, and certainly to Ella Rudolph, who have carried our service, and to Evangelist Friesen in her absence tonight, to our deacons, and each of you who are here in your respective places tonight. Yeah. Our word again is coming out of the book of Romans, the 8th chapter. The book of Romans, we're in chapter 8. That may be where we were the last time we met on a Wednesday night. Amen. Romans, the 8th chapter, we were on the top end the last time. And if you will just bear with me a little bit tonight, just want to hear a few verses to get up out of here. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Romans, the 8th chapter. Now, that's in the New Testament here. That ought to be that book number, what, 6 in the New Testament scripture. Romans, the 8th chapter. I'm going to begin reading at verse number 18. It says, For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
Yes.
For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who have subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from bondage, the bondage of corruption, into the glorious liberty of the children of God.
Yes.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, or that is the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope. But hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why does he yet hope for?
Right,
but if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought to. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searches the hearts knoweth what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Verse 18 says, well, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Just from that verse, just want to use the subject tonight, no comparisons.
All right.
No.
Amen.
Comparison. In our text tonight, as we are yet in the book of Romans, and Paul uses this letter to the church at Rome, which deals with, talks about, and describes sin better than any New Testament book in the Bible. Amen.
All right.
It makes the point or the argument early on that all have sinned.
Yes.
All of us essentially were born in sin and shapen in iniquity.
Yeah.
And sin is something that nobody has to train us for. Amen.
Amen.
Most of us can grow up to be good sinners.
Yeah.
Whether we, you don't have to go to sin school. It's just our nature.
Yeah.
And the problem for most of us is that that's been our lifestyle, that's been our position, that's been our job, our nature, our character for so long, until when we finally hear a word of truth and decide, I want to live for God, that this sinful life is not appealing anymore. I want to do what pleases God. The devil fools us into thinking that some way, somehow, that all that we've been doing all those years, we have some ability within us to just all of a sudden stop. Amen. I don't care where you go for a long time and go a lot of times. Something about that route, you just gonna go even when you don't have to go there no more. Amen. Praise the Lord. And folk who have Alzheimer's, oftentimes who are not even in their right mind, will wander back to some places, not a place they just went one time, but places that they went all the time. Amen. And as sinners, and when we become saved, and I hear folks say that we are saved sinners, and that's not what the Bible says now, that we were sinners before we got saved. Amen. And after we become saved, we're children of God. Amen. We're saints of the Most High God. And the fact that we sin does not mean that we are a sinner. Amen. Any more than the fact that you put a car, the fact that you go in a garage don't make you a car. Amen. The fact that you sin in and of itself does not make you a sinner. Sinners are those who practice sin. Amen. Those who are satisfied with sin. Those who live in sin. Who are content with sin and wear well. Amen. Because you fix a sink don't mean you're a plumber. Amen. Praise the Lord. We have to understand that concept, because the devil won't have all us fools as if though there is no difference. You understand? Well, you ain't no better than nobody. The devil is a liar. I am better than somebody else. I got a better standing than somebody else. A child of God just stands in a better place than a child of the devil. Amen. When we have been adopted as sons of God, we have benefits and privileges that do not belong to the children of the devil. But Paul says that after we are saved, he has dealt now with sin and the power of sin, how sin enslaves us. And when we start out sinning, and it becomes part of us to the point to where even when we want to stop, we just cannot stop. We said I ain't going to do it.
No
more. I don't like it. I'm tired of it. I don't like the feeling I get. I don't want to disappoint God. I don't want to disappoint my family. I don't want to disappoint my church. And yet the thing just keeps coming back at us over and over and over again. And we find that when we really surrender to him.
Yes.
He says in this text early on that we know that Christ come into our hearts,
amen,
not because of a feeling.
That's right.
See, church folk have been trained to operate on feelings for so long.
Yes.
Until folk won't get in the prayer line because they didn't feel nothing.
Amen.
Amen. Folk think they're not saved because they didn't feel nothing. And I know people have messed that up, talking about, I looked at my hand looked new, and looked at my feet in day two, and my feet got light, and all of this stuff. And different people respond to stuff differently, but none of this is scriptural. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And we have to understand that being saved and receiving even the Spirit of God, the most precious, the most powerful thing that God has, and even though it is powerful, the power is not designed to harm us, it's designed to help us. So the Spirit of God, the power of God, does not overpower us in a way to make us Amen. Yes. Does not overpower us in a way to cause us to run like fools and hurt ourselves. That's what people do. It is a spirit, all right. It is a ghost. But I'm not saying it's the Holy Ghost. Amen. Oh, right. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit of God is a gentle spirit. Amen. Cause people have made a mockery out of the Spirit of God. Folk telling you to get down there and call him until we say you got it.
Yes.
Call him until you feel something. But the scripture says that we know that he has come into our heart because we ask and we believe.
Amen.
I don't care how many times you say Jesus, Jesus. Don't care who else is praying with and for you. Until your faith is stronger enough to believe that he's in your heart, you'll never be saved.
Amen.
Scripture says that the man fainted in his heart. So is he. And the devil has a way of playing with our mind. And that's why when you just get it in your mind and not in your heart, that's why the devil can have you feeling saved one day. And I'll tell you the next day.
Amen.
That rascal, I know how long I've been preaching. I know how long I've been saying. And I know what he says to me, so I know he got to be saying some stuff to you too.
Amen. My Lord.
I know how he can try to make you think it's not worth it. Ain't nothing to it. People steadily dying. Trouble still coming. Problems on every side. What good did it do to get saved? It did a lot of good because all of us going to die one way or another.
Amen.
And I ain't going to lie about it. What I understand, I'd much rather die saved than to die not saved.
Amen.
There's a distinct place. See, while we're alive, we can all go whichever way we want to go.
Yeah.
Amen. But when we die, there are only two choices. And that choice has to be made before you die. Paul said, for those who have accepted Christ,
yes,
who are walking by the Spirit of God, find ourselves in sometimes the same predicament as those who are living in the world.
Yes.
You understand that? Non-saved folk get counsel. And so do saved folk.
Yeah.
Unsaved folk get diabetes.
Yeah.
And so do saved folk. And some of us will allow the devil and folk who don't understand God's word to make you believe that because you got saved, these things won't bother you. Mm-hmm. But this is not what the text is telling us tonight. The text is telling us that we all are going to suffer. But the scripture says, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. In other words, you don't want to suffer, the scripture said, as a wrongdoer.
That's all right.
You don't want to suffer as a sinner because there ain't no hope.
Amen.
For the end of your suffering. You're just suffering some little suffering until the big suffering comes. Amen.
Amen.
But for those of us who are saved, we can go through knowing that God is able to deliver us. The scripture says, now have no temptation taken you except what is common unto man.
Yeah.
But God is faithful.
Thank you.
Who will not allow you to be tempted. It didn't say he won't put no more on you. See, folk misquote that. It never said he wouldn't put no more on you. Because first off, God ain't putting nothing on you. It says he will not allow you to be tempted above what you're able to bear, and he will, with the temptation, also make a way for you to escape.
Amen.
Understand God's word. We said here to my God, I know your word said you won't put no more on me than I can. His word didn't say that.
Amen.
God is not putting nothing on you. More times than not, we're putting it on ourselves.
Right now.
Many times we're positioning ourselves where the devil can put stuff on us. It's not God putting anything on us. It's God who is delivering us. It's God who is setting us free. It is God.
Yes, sir.
Keeping us from going over the edge.
Yeah.
He says, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time, no matter what kind of prosecutions the church was going through, no matter what kind of troubles were going on in life, he says, I reckon, I counted, I suppose, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which is going to be revealed in us. You understand that? And we understand it from the worldly standpoint. We just call it no pain, no gain. You understand that? We understand that if you're going to get in shape, if you're going to look fine, and you're going to get fly, you're going to have to turn down the plate. You understand? You're going to have to do some exercise. You're going to have to walk and run and get on the treadmill. And a lot of times that hurts and that's painful. And a lot of times that's a sacrifice. But we understand that we got something to look forward to. You start to first start out.
My Lord.
You not ate a whole meal and passed up a whole Big Mac.
Yeah.
Walked a whole block.
My Lord.
Hungry and tired. And still fat. That's not very encouraging. You know what I'm saying? That's not very encouraging. When you first start, you understand, not drinking the soda, not eating the cake, it's not encouraging because all the weight is still right there.
Right.
Sometimes we have to look beyond what we can see.
Yeah.
You always say that. And think about somebody else who said, this is how I got in shape.
Yeah.
This is how I lost the weight.
Yeah.
And we got to trust that what worked for them will work for us. And all we can tell ourselves while our stomach is growling louder than we talk to ourselves. If I just pass this up a few more times, I'll be able to get back in that size 12. Amen, somebody. I'll be able to get back in that nice dress, them nice pants I got. And a lot of times, that's what we understand from the worldly standpoint. No pain, no gain. Sometimes the scripture says that where there's no oxen, the crib is clean. But the strength comes from the oxen. Amen. So sometimes otherwise, nothing from nothing leaves nothing. So a lot of times we don't want to put up with people. We don't want to put up with God. We try to protect our hearts and protect ourselves without getting involved in something. And as a result of that, nothing from nothing. Always believe nothing. Some of us have been made to believe that it was better before we got saved. The devil will try to tell you that. He'll try to show you where you didn't have all this problem till you start coming to church. And it did look like that. The problem was you didn't have sense enough to know you had problems.
Yeah.
You overlooked those problems.
Amen.
I was telling somebody today, I used to work with a man that had cancer and didn't know he had cancer. And he used to drink very heavily, as a lot of our black men do when something is wrong with them. And they just try to drink it away. And he went to the doctor with stomach problems. They cut him open and had to close him back up right then and told him, you got about 2 months to live. That's about how long he lived. And sometimes we think that if we just, in other words, he think he was better off not knowing what I'm trying to say. And so sometimes he was sick, but he didn't have the wherewithal to know he was sick. He tried to drink it away. And sometimes we can't see how bad things are. That's why folks stay high all the time. That's why folks always got to put something in their system. And you know, with a rational mind, with a sane mind, you can tell just how bad something is. Y'all ain't saying that. A green light always looks green when you're sober.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Amen.
All right. Amen.
Amen. You know, running through it, talking about I thought it was green. See, what being saved does is just sobers your soul that you can the pitfall. I can see the trap. I can see what the devil is trying to do to me. And not only that, I can trust in a Savior who can deliver me from everything that the enemy tried to do to me.
Amen.
I think that's a whole lot better.
Oh, yeah.
You're going around with your eyes closed.
Mm-hmm.
Feeling your way groping at night. And don't know your left hand from the right hand. But the devil wants us to think. When we had fans money, things were better.
My Lord.
They wasn't better. He just wants you to think that.
That's right. Amen.
Fans money, you have to get fast sleep. Y'all ain't saying that. You can't sleep at night. You always got to look around. And I enjoy driving, and when the police drive, I can drive right by.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
Mm-hmm. I don't have to land back when I see the police coming. You understand that? I don't have to turn off and cut my headlights off when the police coming. And the devil wants you to think that's better. Y'all ain't saying that. If I'm going south, I think I'm not having to go no way for south.
All right.
Yeah.
So true.
That's right.
Yeah, if I'm going to Lincoln Park, I don't think I ought to leave here and have to go downtown dodging somebody.
Amen.
And the devil wants you to believe that that makes more sense. He says, but the sufferings of this present time, whatever you go, all I'm saying is whatever you go through as a child of God is far better than going through as a child of the devil.
Amen.
He said he's not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
Uh-huh.
So those same folk were looking down, those same, because there are folk in the world who make those comparisons.
Yeah,
they will say, he in church all the time, but still ain't got nothing.
Amen.
She's still in church all the time, ain't got no one, ain't doing no better. I may not look like I'm doing no better, but a folk of us down tonight, y'all ain't saying that. I feel on this position a whole lot better than those who chose not to come over. I know what God has promised me, and just because you don't see it doesn't mean that it's not that. And now the distinct difference in giving you everything you want and supplying all of your needs. Y'all ain't saying that. I don't have to sleep by double. You give him God. You accept him. And God will supply your need. And not only will he supply your need, the scripture says delight yourself therefore in the Lord, and he'll give you the desire of your heart.
Yes, he will. I know he will.
That goes beyond supplying your needs.
Yes, he'll.
But you have to make him your joy.
Amen.
Not I want to go shoot pool, but I got to go to church.
All right.
Not I want to go to the movies, but we got to go to church.
Uh-huh.
I never say I got to go to church. I say I get to go to church.
Amen.
I don't see it as a duty, but I see it as a privilege.
Amen.
I take pride and joy in being able to come with some like-minded folk. Some folk who have been through as much as I have been through. Some folk who don't mind telling God, thank you. Some folk who recognize that he's worthy of praise. Some folk who recognize that he's worthy for us to come in this place and give him worship tonight. With the eyes open. When you take coming to church as a duty or simple responsibility, can't find no joy in the house of God. And I told you before, many folk, the reason why they can't find joy in the house of God is because the joy don't come from the music.
All right, amen. Amen.
Sometimes it just reminds us of stuff.
All right, all right.
Sometimes, I mean, you can dance in here and you can dance out there, but I'm talking about the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord comes from doing what pleases God. So what we do on the outside before we come on the inside determines the level of joy we'll have when we get on the inside.
Right.
So if you do everything, you're big enough and bad enough to do on the outside and rush up in here and think that on your retreat, y'all ain't saying that.
Right.
Think that in your recess here. Think that while you in here for your little break, y'all ain't saying that God will overflow you with joy. I promise you it don't work that way. But I challenge you to do something that God is pleased with, to do a good deed for somebody. somebody, to tell somebody about the goodness of God, to be a witness for God, and then come in this place and see what God move on your heart. See what God give you joy. See what He fill your cup and let it overflow.
Amen.
Amen.
So true. So true.
Nothing
but the true word.
For folk who think that you can just run in. And then you wonder and look at it, folk, talking about wonder if they for real.
Amen.
How come they can feel something that I can't feel?
There you go.
Chances are they did something that you wouldn't do. And then chances are they refrained from doing something that you had to do. The joy don't come from the song. It just stirs up something. The joy don't come from the music. It just motivates us sometimes. But the joy comes from pleasing God. The joy of the Lord is our strength tonight. He says, but there's no comparison for the sufferings compared to the glory that we're going to experience. For he says, the earnest expectation of the creature, all mankind, is waiting for the manifestation, or waiting for the revelation of the sons of God. And if you really think back to the Garden of Eden, he says, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. In other words, I didn't make myself like this, but by reason of him who have subjected the same in hope. In other words, all of us, no matter who you are, how good you look. No matter how good you feel. No matter who told you you had it going on. The reality is there are signs every day that this old body is decaying. This old flesh is headed back from where it came from. And all of us, no matter who we are longing for a better place. And you understand that? And we're longing. I'm talking to somebody today and they said they wish they knew somebody that was rich. I couldn't make no sense out of that. Why don't you just wish you were rich? The fact that you knew somebody that was rich wouldn't necessarily make them give you nothing.
Amen.
Amen.
But all of us don't necessarily find nothing wrong with the world itself, but something is wrong with us, the position of our body, the fact that we can't see no more, we can't walk, we can't get around, and the reality is enough people have died to make us believe that we too are dying. And he says we long for the expectation, and we're waiting for the revelation from God, for the creature. I didn't make myself, and I didn't make it appointed for man to die one time. But I have hope in God that when I die, I can live again.
Amen.
When we think about life in the Garden of Eden, where there was no work, no getting tired, no sin and no sorrow, until sin came in the world, and then sin brought on death, sin brought on sickness, sin brought on corruption, sin brought on bondage. And all of us, no matter who we are, there's no means of escaping sin and shame. There's no ability within us, oh Lord, to escape sickness and death. All of us come to realize that even if you are up today, behind you Sunday, to be down on tomorrow, even if you never had so much as a headache, we still understand that this life will soon be over. And it's the vanity that Solomon talked about, saying you live all your life trying to accumulate stuff. and things all just to die and leave it all behind. And as we suffer as children of God, we long for a better place. We long for a better life. Somebody say, Captain, take me away. Somebody's mindset is, if I had the wings of a dove, I would fly and there be a rest. Oh, yeah. And we recognize tonight that he said the whole creation is groaning and travailing in pain together right now. The good have to suffer with the bad. The Christians have to get sick just like the non-Christians. All of us are subject to faults and failures. All of us, oh yeah, are subject to sickness and sin. But we wait and trust in the Lord, realizing that after a while, it's going to all be over. He talked about being in travail. Hallelujah. And we think about every woman who has ever given birth, how you go through labor pains. And during those labor pains, you don't want to see the baby daddy. Except to put your hand around his neck. In those labor pains, you're thinking about, if I could just get through this. And sometimes it makes you say, I'm not going to never have a child again. But as soon as the baby breaks out, as soon as the pain is over, everybody realizes that having this beautiful baby was worth all of the trouble. And what Paul is saying, when we get through suffering here, when the labor pains are over, it's going to be well worth it. All that we go through, the Lord is able to deliver us. And I heard him say, eyes have not seen and ears haven't heard, have it entered in the hearts of man, the good thing that God has in store for them that love him. I don't know about you, but I love him because he's been good to me. I love him on my good days, and I love him on my bad days. I love him with a love, and I love him with a wake up in the morning and the arthritis is going to be as bad. Some of us, all we can imagine is knowing somebody with something, not having something ourselves. Some of us, the best we can hope for is that on tomorrow I have a better day than I had today. But what Paul is saying, this goes beyond that. We're going through a dark tunnel, but just going in this dark tunnel, knowing that on the other side there is light. Longing for the redemption of the body. See, I know my soul is all right, but this body just keep on aching. Somebody said, I have a leak in this old building. My soul has got to prove we grow. We know that light at the end of the road. We know that he that promised is faithful. That he who began a great work is able to keep that work. He said, for which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet our inward man is renewed day by day. This old flesh is decaying. And I can play around and fake it, but I can't go all in. We don't have no trust because everything seems temporary. And sometimes it make it not worth worrying about. And some folks say, why get it if I'm gonna lose it anyhow? But I found something. The scripture says, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon this earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, where thieves can break through and steal. But lay up treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust can corrupt, where thieves cannot break through. He said, for where your treasure is, there be the heart of thee also. My heart is not in my home. My heart is not in my car. My heart is not in healthy relationships. My heart is not on a job.
Sometimes.
while we're here.
Hallelujah.
In the wilderness.
Yeah.
While we're here, not knowing how to get from one moment to the next. While we're here, can I have one problem?
Amen.
Don't look at the problem, but look to the problem solver. He said, sometimes it gets so rough, so we don't even know what and how to pray. But because we got him, the Spirit knows about us. It knows what we need. And it makes intercession for us.
Amen.
The Spirit tells God all about our troubles.
Yes.
Sometimes you don't have words to say. Mm. Sometimes you just can't get it out.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you hear him say, we know. And I hear folk all the time talking about when God is in control. Mm. I want you to know he always was in control.
All right.
And how that control affects you is dependent upon your relationship with him.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
In other words, he's in control when bad things happen to you.
Right.
And he's in control when good things happen to you. If you'd rather good things happen to you, while he's in control, you ought to have a relationship with him.
Amen.
You ought to obey him.
Yeah.
You live out his promises. He said, we know. This is what it said.
My Lord.
We know
that
all things work together.
Yes, sir.
For the good. Don't you mix that up. It didn't say they all felt good.
My Lord.
Didn't say it all looked good. Didn't say you understood all of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's working for the good. He moving jokers out your way and you don't even understand.
Right, all right.
You crying over folk that's been keeping you down.
My Lord.
He moving folk. He moving stuff. He moving jobs.
That's right. Amen.
Heard Isaiah say, I'm through in the alley. King of thou died. Our soul sought it all. Perhaps as long as us I was living, he couldn't see the law for looking at us
out.
And in our life, some stuff got to die. Some folk got to die out. I heard him say, every branch in me to bring forth fruit. That's real about growing. That's real about fruit. The tree is growing. The one with fruit, that's the one you cut. And it's hardest thing for me, if I done got me two little peaches on there, I don't want to cut it now. Some of us don't want to cut. That ain't nothing.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Them little hard things ain't got no sweet. Go cut that.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Some of us think we got something.
All right.
Amen.
But he said, I am the true vine.
Yeah.
Every branch.
Yes, sir.
That abide in me and bring forth fruit.
Amen.
I purge it.
Lord.
Sometimes you're going through, you're just purging. I know that can't feel good cutting something.
Mm-hmm.
But look at the results.
That's right, amen.
Ooh, and we just wouldn't keep drawing back.
Thank you.
Let him go and do the work.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
How much farther along will we be?
Got that right.
And when you think about it, it's not God's fault. It then becomes our fault. Because we don't like how this feels.
That's right.
I don't want to be by myself. You can do better by yourself sometimes.
My Lord.
When God got ready to anoint Saul as king,
yes.
I heard Samuel tell him, bid the servants. The path on before us. But you stand still a while.
Amen.
So I can show you the word of God.
Amen.
Someone's going to let some stuff and some things pass on by us.
All right now, amen.
We're trying to stay in step with everything and everybody.
Amen.
If it ain't pulling you and encouraging you to come to the church.
Amen. That's it.
Amen. If it ain't pulling you and encouraging you to come toward God.
Amen.
Lord,
so true.
Don't yield to
Lord.
It.
Amen.
God bless tonight.
Thank
you. Whatever you're going through,
amen.
There's something far more exceeding, greater. Not even compared.
No.
And I told you, when woman give birth and she look on that beautiful baby every day, she so soon forgot about all those labor pains.
Amen.
You don't look at the baby every day and think back about it.
Yeah.
Hop at the labor pain. What the baby smiling and giggling and gaga and la la la. You ain't thinking about labor pain.
Amen.
It make you forget what you said when you was in labor. You said you wasn't gonna have no more. The baby get to smile and titty hee hee, and you in that. Oh, no. That's enough of it. Got something else. Use that prayer tonight. You come to the altar this time, amen.